Okay, let's now talk about extending the input normalization to the hidden layers using the technique called batch normalization. I will just show you in this video how it works, and then in the next video I will show you how we can use it in PyTorch, and then I will show you or explain to you why it works. Or at least we will discuss some of the theories trying to explain why it works. All right, so batch normalization, or in short, batch norm, goes back to a paper published in 2015 called Batch Normalization, Accelerating Deep Network Training by Reducing Internal Covariate Shift. So internal covariate shift, that's like, I don't know, a fancy word for just saying that the feature distributions shift during the course of the training internally in the hidden layers. We will explain or think about this more when I go to the video where I offer some theories why batch normalization works well in practice. So here, just the the short version of batch normalization, what it is. It's about normalizing the hidden layer inputs. So instead of just normalizing the inputs to the network, we normalize also internally the inputs to each hidden layer. And this helps with exploding and vanishing gradient problems, so that the gradients don't become too large or too small. And overall, it can increase the stability during training. So in that way, training progresses more smoothly, and also the convergence rate improves. That means it may be that we need fewer epochs to get the same loss that we would achieve if we don't use batch norm. So usually with batch norm, the networks train faster. And how you can think of it is as an additional normalization layer. And there are also some additional trainable parameters involved. So in the next couple of slides, I'm going to walk you through the procedure of batch normalization. So just for context, let's suppose we have a multi-layer perceptron. So let's say we focus in on this activation here in the second hidden layer. So the first activation in the second hidden layer. And we are actually looking at the net input of that activation. So remember how we compute the activation. So it's usually by applying activation function to the net input. What type of activation function doesn't really matter here. It could be logistic sigmoid, 10H, or ReLU. Should work with any type of activation function. All right, so we are focusing on this hidden layer net input corresponding to the activation here now. And also now suppose we have a mini batch. So we have a mini batch such that the net input of a given training example at layer 2 is written as follows. So I have now this index I here for the index of the training example in that mini batch. So if I have I equals 1, this would be the first example in that mini batch. And just for simplicity, I will actually ignore the layer index in the next couple of slides, just so that the notation is a little bit simpler to read. So here that's the first step of batch norm. There are two steps. So the first step is to normalize the net inputs. This is essentially the same as the standardization that I explained earlier for the inputs. So what's going on here is we are computing the mean over a feature. So the J is the feature index again. So you can actually use batch norm for any type of input. So we will also see there is a two-dimensional version for that for convolutional networks later on. But here we are just focusing on the regular one-dimensional version where you have a feature vector, for instance. So let's say we have the jth feature. And if I go back, so if you consider this activation here, what are the features? So the features are all essentially all the previous layer activations, right? So all these go into that activation. So all of these here are the features of this activation here. So J really is the index over the activations from the previous layers, or we can also think of it as the feature index, or previous, which are the previous layers activations. So we compute from that the mean and the variance. So that is nothing that should be new to you. It's a simple calculation here. And then we standardize. So this is like what we had in a previous video as standardization. And this is essentially it. So in that way, step one of BatchNorm is similar to the input standardization. Except now we are looking at a hidden layer. So instead of looking at standardizing X, we are now standardizing these A's from the previous layer. So after step one comes step two. So one more thing to say about step one. So in practice, we modify this standardization slightly, such that we don't bump into division zero issues if the variance is zero, if there's no variance. So for numerical stability, we add a small value epsilon here. So here we have the variance plus this little epsilon, and then we take the square root instead of dividing by the standard deviation directly. That's just like a small computational trick to prevent division by zero errors. Now step two. So step two is the pre-activation scaling. What do I mean by pre-activation? So this is the value that is computed before the activation is computed. And it will become more clear in the next slides, where I have step one and step two connected to each other. So this is essentially what we have done in the previous slide. So if I go back, this is the end of step one. And then from step one, we go here to step two, where we apply a scaling. So there is a gamma j and a beta j. And both of these are learnable parameters that are also learned using backpropagation. So similar to the weights in the network, these are also updated via backpropagation. So what do these do? I mean, essentially, there is a scaling parameter here, and there is a shift parameter, right? So technically, it can learn to undo what we just did in step one, right? So it essentially can undo it. So if gamma I, if that happens to be equal to, let's say, this term, and beta j happens to be equal to this one, I mean, these are learnable, so it may happen. So the network can actually learn to undo step one, the scaling or standardization. Whether it does that or not, it really depends. But I'm just saying here the possibility exists that it can undo this. But in that way, what's happening here is it's something that is a little bit more flexible than just regular standardization. So here, step one would be a regular standardization of the hidden layer activations. And step two is a little bit more, I would say, flexible. So technically, this whole step one and step two thing can just simplify to regular standardization if this is given, or it could be something different. And in practice, it happens that this setup, the step one and step two setup, works better than just step one alone. It just happens so. And one theory, or could be, it's just my theory that I'm coming up with, but one simple explanation could be, for example, it might perform better because we just have additional learnable parameters. It's essentially as if we have more parameters in the network, so the network has a higher capacity maybe. But we will look at some other theories in a future video. All right. So as I said, this controls the mean and this controls the spread or scale. So from this one and this one, basically. And like I also already said, technically a batch anomaly could learn to perform standardization with a zero min and unit variance if these are the same and these are the same. So here is step one and step two connected and summarized. So yeah, I'm not showing you the numerically stable version, but you probably know, you can also do it. Doesn't really matter. It's just for keeping things simple. So here's the whole procedure of how it would look like. Here I'm applying it to both this layer and this layer. So the colors should match here. So let's say X is our input. Then we first compute the net input. So if we are here, we are computing the net input. And then this would be step one, where we standardize the net input. Then what we do is we compute this pre-activation scaling. So this is a scaling. And then we compute the activation. So the activation in this case would be computed by sigma, or let me write this down properly, A1, 1. This would be sigma A prime 1, 1, right? And then once we have that, we go to the next input. So this is the next net input. Then again, we do step one. So here we again, step one. And then we do step two. And then we compute again the activation. Oh, it should be a one here. Sigma A 1, 2 prime. So yeah, this is essentially it. And yeah, this is how BatchNorm works. Do I have anything more? One more thing to consider is that this one also makes the bias redundant, right? So I'm not showing the bias unit here in this network, but technically you would have a bias unit B1 here, here a B2, here a B3 that gets added to the net input, right? So that is something you are familiar with. And if you think about how the bias works, right? So if I have a simple case here, the net input, it's write it like W, just for a simplified case. So let's say I'm computing the net input for the second layer. This would be weights from the first layer. Multiplied by the activation from the first layer, here layer 1 and layer 1, and then plus the bias. So I'm only considering here simple case, omitting the index, otherwise I would have another index. But yeah, you know what I mean. So I would have the bias added to it, right? But this kind of becomes redundant, because essentially the bias could be already included in this beta, or the beta would essentially, if you leave out this bias here, the beta would essentially take the role of that bias if we compute batch norm. So in that sense, you can skip the bias when you define the layers. I will show you that in the code example, how we can do that. I mean, it doesn't really matter, but whether we do it or not, it should work both ways in practice. But it's just, I would say, a little bit cleaner to not use the bias, because it's redundant. I will show you in the next video in the code example how that looks like. So you can actually, via an argument, say bias equals false. Yeah, and also note that now when we use BatchNorm, BatchNorm has learnable parameters. So if we use BatchNorm in a given layer, we have an additional two vectors that have the same dimension as the bias vector, right? So if we use BatchNorm here in this layer, we will have two four-dimensional vectors. Like this bias vector here would also be four-dimensional, right? Because there's one bias for each hidden layer activation. All right, so I think, this is all I have about BatchNorm. This is how BatchNorm works. In my slides, I actually had also a short, not short, it was actually like 10 slides or so, how we do backpropagation with BatchNorm, but I promised you not to torture you with these nitty-gritty details and mathematical details, because that's not super important, because we use autograd in practice anyway. And I think it's in this course also more important to understand the bigger picture concepts, and then if you're interested, you can study those things later on. So yeah, and also if we would start like going through these slides, it would take another half an hour. And I would rather complete this lecture today so that next lecture we can talk about optimizers and move on to convolutional networks. I hope you don't mind. So in that way, next video I will show you batch norm in PyTorch.